darkest place, life, even in the pain, it feels like coming home. Where the Spirit is, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. I am free, amen. Where the Spirit
Hello and welcome. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be amongst us as we gather together today. Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins and whose mercy endures forever. Welcome to our online Anglican prayer book service for the season of Lent. These services are pre-recorded and each week we add in our hymns and our Bible readings for the week and our sermon for the week. So as we progress through the service, you might notice the video is taken from a different spot in our church or recorded at a different time. There's just a heads up for that. Later in the service, we'll be having communion and I'll invite you at the time to pray a prayer of spiritual communion with us. But if you wish as well, you might like to pause the video and gather some bread and juice so that you're ready to have that as well at that time. Our church service here at Warragul Anglican Church is held on the traditional lands of the Gunai Kurnai people, our traditional owners, and I'd like to pay my respects to their elders, past and present, as we commence our service. Let's also commence by reminding ourselves of some great words of Scripture, and I want to read for you today from Matthew chapter 4. A person does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. And a little later, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God has arrived. Come near, repent and believe in the good news. So let us pray as we start our service. Father, at this time of Lent, we acknowledge that our lives are bound up in our relationship with you. Our lives are more than working and eating and shopping. Our lives are more than our families and friends. Our life is in you, and in Jesus, you are the bread of our life. And as we prepare this Lent season to remember our need for salvation and the work on the cross of our glorious Redeemer, brother and friend, the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray that you would search us, examine us, confront us, cleanse us and renew us. Give us new life. Give us repentant hearts and lead us deeper into the life of your kingdom that is drawn near. Meet with us as we gather around your word. Hear us and accept our worship. Well, thank you again for joining with us. We gather today in the name of Jesus Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive from God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, for ourselves, for our churches, to seek forgiveness for our sins, that all of this, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we may give ourselves to the service of God. Let's pray our prayer of preparation. Redeemer God, we come to you in this season of Lent, conscious of our weakness, dismayed by our feeble faith, yearning to show repentance from our heart, yearning to serve you as we should. But we also come gladly. We come with confidence because we know you are a gracious God, slow to punish, swift to forgive, always looking to bless us, to restore and renew. God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, friends, we're going to have our first hymn now, followed by our Bible readings for the week and then our sermon. Our Bible reading today is once again from the Gospel of Mark, Mark chapter 12, verse 28 through to 34. One of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked them, "Of all the commandments, which is the most important?" "The most important one," said Jesus, "is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. The second is like it: Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these." "Well said, teacher," the man replied. "You're right in saying that God is one and that there is no other but him. To love him with all our heart and all your understanding, with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices." When Jesus saw that he'd answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." And from then on, No one dared ask him any more questions, for the gospel of our Lord, glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Well, thanks for joining with us again today as we continue in our series looking at the greatest commandment. And over the last few weeks, we've looked at this great commandment to love the Lord our God with all of our heart and mind, with all of our soul, and with all of our, today we're looking at our strength. So over the last few weeks, we've looked at what it means to love God with our hearts, that center, our kind of like executive center, our will that determines so much of what we do in life. To love God with our mind, to submit all of our thinking to His glory, and to His glorious service. To love God with our soul, that part of us that relates to God, that supernatural, spiritual part of us which goes on forever. To love God with our soul. And today we think about what it means to love God with our strength. I think there's a really important reason why that came at the end, because I think if we can work out how to love God with our heart and our soul and our mind, then it will naturally flow that we will love God with all of our strength as well. The Greek word for strong in the New Testament is quite tricky to pronounce, ischus, strong. And it means to be able to do something. It's talking about our capabilities, our abilities. Also, our very health is our strength, because with our health and our vitality, we can do lots of things. When we look at the way the equivalent word is used in the Old Testament, it there is used in reference to things like physical strength, talks about the strength of the Israelite army, or, you know, Samson, the character in the Old Testament who was super strong, the word is used of him. It's used of God, of divine strength. It's used of intellectual strength. In the book of Proverbs, wisdom is equated to strength. I'll read to you from Proverbs chapter 8, verse 14. Counsel and sound judgment are mine. I have insight. I have power. So our wisdom can be our strength. In the New Testament, it's quite a common word, and it refers to the strength and the power of living creatures. There are some interesting nuances in the book of Hebrews in chapter 6 and 11, where it talks about Christian people being made strong out of weakness, and God giving strong encouragement towards our hope, which is, you know, there's some beautiful nuances. But generally, it's about our strength, our power, as people. In Mark chapter 14 and Matthew chapter 26, Jesus uses the word when he's speaking to the disciples, and he comes back and he's disappointed with them, and he says, you know, were you not able to stay awake and to watch just for an hour? Able, this word able, that's translated able, that is this Greek word for strong. Well, you're not able to commit all of your ability to just staying awake for an hour and watching. In Acts 10, it's used in reference to Jesus. God anointed Jesus with strength and with power, and he used that strength and power to go about doing good works and to heal and to bring freedom for the oppressed. So loving God with all of our strength is about us deploying our abilities in the service of that love of God, using those abilities that God has given us as a vehicle, an expression, a way of loving God. There's a significant reference, I think, in 1 Chronicles chapter 29. It says, talks about God being strong and God giving strength. 1 Chronicles 29 verse 12, wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. In your hands are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all. So it's a wonderful verse which talks about God as being strong. If we want to know what strong is, think about God. It's part of one of his characteristics. But also that God gives strength to all. Jesus, of course, is our model for how to fulfill this command. Jesus fulfilled this command to love the Father with all of his heart and his mind and his soul and all of his abilities. Jesus, we read, never sinned, so we can be confident that Jesus did fulfill this command. So what did it look like for Jesus to fulfill this command? Well, when we think about Jesus, Jesus was like us, ordinary actually in many ways, forgettable by some, unbelievable to others. You know, there were people who challenged him and who said of him, "Who is that? Is that like Joseph's son, the carpenter?" You know, in many ways, Jesus was ordinary. In many ways, Jesus was not, you know, the kind of superhero that we see in movies today. He was overcome by the Pharisees. He was crucified. His public ministry only lasted 3 years. We can look at those from different angles, but in many ways, Jesus was ordinary. But he fulfilled this command. It's great encouragement to us all that this is not about being a superhero. We can all love God with our abilities. The thing with Jesus is that he committed all of his strength, all of his ability, he committed it to the love of the Father and the Father's agenda, the Father's mission to save humanity. He committed all of his ability and strength to the love of the Father, fellowship with the Father and with the Spirit. And God in turn anointed Jesus and gave him, God the Father anointed Jesus and gave him more strength, more ability in order to do good work, in order to serve the Father's plans for the world. Well, let's take this command and think about ourselves. We are to love God with all of our strength. Love the Lord your God with all your strength. Let's pose it as a question to ourselves. Do you love God with all of your strength? It's a deeply challenging question, isn't it? It sounds undoable. It sounds impossible. But remember, it's not about being the strongest. It's about whatever ability God has given us already. Whatever abilities we have, we can use them. We can use them to love God back in a very natural way. So are we giving back to God those abilities that God has given us? All of our strengths, all of our health and vitality. Are we using that to say, this is the way I love God, because I use what God has given me in order to love him back. And I do that by loving God, loving fellowship with God, loving God's people, loving God's world, being committed to God's mission. All of those things, my talents, I bring them. All those things that people say, oh, you're good at, you know, you fill in the blank. You're good at, are you using that to love God? Deeply challenging. I fear for you as listeners feeling guilty. I don't want to make you feel guilty. I want to inspire you. So we'll get to that in a moment. But you know, initially I think this can make us feel guilty, especially if you're one of the people who declined doing some serving role at church this week, you know, or you've said no to someone. I don't want you to feel guilty. And I wouldn't even dare ask this question of you. But it's not me asking, it's God. It's God who's making this demand. It's Jesus who says this is the greatest command for us. Love God, the Lord our God, with all your strength. Doesn't matter if you're 15 or 50 or 85, God would not command what we could not do. He makes it possible for us to fulfill this command too, to love God with all of our strength. What might that look like for you? If you were able to tick that box and say, yes, I'm using all of my abilities to love God, it might mean, for example, if your abilities are in the medical field, that you're thinking, how can my role, my current role, be an expression of my love for God? Or you might be thinking entrepreneurially, with all of my medical gifts, could I go and start a hospital somewhere where it's needed? Could I use that to love God by loving God's world? What would it look like for me in my family to use all of my abilities, all of my healthiness, my strength? What would it mean to use those in my family as an expression of love for God? What would it look like in my relationships? to be loving God through them with all of my ability? What would it look like in my community, in my church, in my decision making, in my spending and the way I allot my time? What would it look like for me as I allot my time to use my time to measure my days and to use those as a vehicle to love God back? God has given you ability, vitality, whatever you've got, you can use it to love God back. But it's not easy. And I want to suggest three great challenges that every person needs to overcome in order to fulfill this command, to love God with all of our strength. Firstly, we must get over our individualism. Anthropologists talk about how different cultures can be individualistic or more community-focused. Eastern culture tends to be more community-focused, more others-centered. But Western culture is very individualistic. And by individualism, they're talking about an individual's drive to act on their private interests, to look after themselves. So the temptation for all of us in the West will be, let's use our ability to serve our own interests, you know, to build our own little empire, to look after our own little family, rather than thinking about God, big thoughts about God and the world and the community that God's placed us in. It's not that in the West we don't serve God and use our abilities in the service of others as well. Remembering that Jesus said, you know, when you serve any of these, you're serving me, you're loving me. It's not that we don't volunteer. I read about a study that was written up by New York University that showed that in America, it was in the early 2000s, I think maybe about 2007, they'd done some research and worked out that 26% of the population in America had served in some voluntary capacity, serving in their community or whatever, or their local church, wherever it was. 26%, that's millions of people. So, you know, there's plenty of people in the West who are volunteering. But 26% makes you think, well, that's a lot of people. That's over 70% who are not volunteering. In an entire year, can't say, yes, I volunteered this year. And the researchers also found that a good third of volunteers actually give up after a year. They say after a year, I'm no longer available for whatever the volunteering was. So we have some really big challenges to overcome in the West around our individualism. We must get over ourselves, as it were, in order to love God with all of our strength. It's a big barrier for us, perhaps bigger than it is for some other cultures. This last week, I visited one of our parishioners who lives in the hostel at Fairview, which is one of our aged care centres in our community. His name is Bert. He'll be well known to some of you who are watching this. And Bert, the thing is, he wouldn't be known to many of the young people in our church. He used to live across the road from church. And Bert, over the years, he's now in his 80s, but Bert has served the local church as a handyman, on parish council, as a church warden, as the church photographer. When I visited him, there was a framed plaque on his wall, which was a thank you from this church for all of his service. But not only did he serve his church, he was a volunteer firefighter for many years. He volunteered with St. John Ambulance and Red Cross. These days, we would say to someone like Bert, Bert, you've got to learn to say no. But Bert managed to do all of those things and to have a family with five children, and yet to do all of those wonderful acts of service. All of that can't be explained simply by the fact that we seem to be a bit busy these days, busier. There is something in our thinking, there is something in our whole worldview that is deeply challenged by this command to love God with all of our strength. Second challenge, I think, is to approach the command as Jesus did. So remember the context, an expert in the law, the law of the commandments of God, really, comes to Jesus and says, What's the greatest commandment? So there were hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of laws that the Jewish people tried to follow. And in answering the question, Jesus does this beautiful thing of taking everyone's gaze off the laws, the hundreds, take them off the law itself. You know, let's not talk about the things we must do. It takes our gaze off that and instead turns our gaze towards heaven, towards God, towards the Father who first loved us. Love the Lord your God. That's the first part of this sentence. Love the Lord your God. When we focus on that, when we love God with our heart and our mind and our soul, I think there's a reason this one, the strength, the abilities, comes at the end, because when we devote ourselves to loving God, using our abilities is going to flow naturally, not out of a sense of compulsion, not driven by guilt, but driven innately by this wonderful relationship, this depth of relationship, this depth of love that we have for God. So I think let's approach this as Jesus did and as Jesus modeled for us. Dive into that relationship with God, and we know we have the mechanisms for doing that. Pray. We need to pray while we're on our own, not just when we're with other people or at church. We need to read God's word. Those two things, reading God's word and private prayer, private reading of scripture, private prayer, they are the keys that unlock a relationship that is increasingly characterized by depth with the Father and with the Son and the Spirit. And when we do that, using our abilities for God, it's going to come naturally. So let this be the year that we dive deeper into our love of God, into that relationship with God. But the third challenge I want to mention is that I think we need to have some clarity about where our church, which for you might be Warragul or you might be watching from somewhere else, your local church, where it fits into you obeying this command. Where does your local church fit in? Because, you know, the church is not our only way to love God with all of our strength, but it is part of the way, and it is an essential part, and it's designed by God. God has given us a family. God describes the church as his family, and therefore the people at church are like our brothers and sisters. And the church is this wonderful, sorry to use the word again, wonderful vehicle for us to express our love for God by loving our brothers and sisters, by serving our church and the mission, because it's part of serving God's bigger mission in the world. So, like, we can't love God in any significant way without loving God's children, without loving the family that we are a part of. It would be, you know, to say, oh God, I love you, but I can't really stand those people at church. Oh God, I go for some teaching. That would be like someone in your own biological family saying, I don't really care about you. I'm just here because you feed me or you clothe me. I'm just here for what I can gain from it. You know, God has invited us into his family. Jesus said that we are to love our brothers and sisters. So there's three great challenges: to get over ourselves enough as Western Christians, to somehow overcome this great individualism which we have inherited, created, we swim in all day, all week. We need to get over that and to approach this command as Jesus did, loving God, diving deeper into that relationship, so that these things simply become the natural fruit out of that relationship. And to think about how we can, in simple or not so simple ways, love God through our service in the local church. We so need people to serve in the church. We so need you to do that in order that the church can go on, in order that the church can go on to teach children of the next generation about Jesus, in order that the church might be part of God's bigger mission in its community and in the world, in order that as a church we can support our missionaries. All of that requires each one of us to love God with our abilities. What a challenge. Let me close in prayer for us. Heavenly Father, Thank you for inviting us into your family. Thank you, Lord, for the salvation that you bring us in Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, that no matter what we actually do, you love us. You loved us first, and because of Jesus, you will always love us and accept us. And yet, Lord, you also challenge us today. Holy Spirit, transform us. Dwell in us that we might have this wonderful, loving fellowship with Father, Spirit, and Son. And as a consequence of that, that all that we do with our abilities is a natural outflow of that. What a blessing that will be. What a blessing. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Friends, I hope that God has spoken to you today through his word as it was read and preached, or through the prayers that we've prayed or the hymns that we've heard today. Let's have a moment of silent reflection where we can each listen to God and pray to him ourselves. Let's continue in prayer for everyone and for the church throughout the world. This is a prayer for our country in a time of pandemic. Great God and Heavenly Father, please come powerfully to our nation in these dark and difficult days. Please slow the spread of the coronavirus through our land, and please protect the vulnerable from its touch. Please lay your healing hands upon those who may now be infected and restore them to health and strength. Please comfort the families of those who have died from this disease. Fill their hearts with your presence and gather around them friends, family, and neighbours who will comfort and support in their time of loss. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the gift of modern medicine. And thank you for the passion and dedication of medical staff and first responders everywhere. Please give each one of them your wisdom in every decision they make. Protect and sustain them, and give them strength, energy, and courage that they need to carry on. Please guide the minds of our leaders in the decisions that they will make that affect all our lives. Lead them to act wisely, carefully, and in the best interests of all. Help all of our leaders to work together that the whole world may overcome this challenging virus. Please shine your light on the path ahead and draw close to the anxious hearts and troubled minds of those who are under stress. Please protect them and their families and guide them day by day and step by step. Please give each one of us the calmness and wisdom that we need to carry us together through these days and weeks and months ahead. Please plant into the heart of every person in this nation the spirit to love our neighbours as ourselves, to follow in the footsteps of Jesus in caring for those around us, friends and strangers alike. And as you draw our community together, may it be drawn together in love. Please, loving Heavenly Father, draw especially close to you those who may be alone or troubled at this time. Calm their troubled hearts and move their friends, family, and acquaintances to call them and encourage and support them. Thank you, Father, that you understand our suffering, for you too have suffered. You have seen your beloved child suffer rejection, humiliation, and death on the cross to rescue us from the powers of darkness. Please bring, finally, great good out of this pandemic as only you can. You turned Christ's humiliation into a victory for the whole world. You turn failure into success. You change our destinies. You take what is evil and you turn it into something good. Please do that now in our world and in our lives. Remind each of us that we do not need to make the journey of life on our own, in our own strength, but that you are here as close to us as our own breath, to surround us with your powerful protective arms and guide us in your path. And we ask all these things for this country, for these people that we love, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Father, we ask that you would accept our prayers through Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Friends, as we approach our time of confession and communion, let's prepare our hearts by reading one of the ancient psalms of lament from the Old Testament. It's Psalm 42, longing for God and his help in distress. As the deer longs for the running brooks, so my soul longs for you, O God. My soul is thirsty for God, thirsty for the living God. When shall I come and see his face? My tears have been my food day and night, while they ask me all day long, where now is your God? As I pour out my soul by myself, I remember this, how I went to the house of the Mighty One, into the temple of God, to the shouts and songs of thanksgiving, a multitude keeping high festival. Why are you so full of heaviness, my soul? Why so much unquiet within me? Put your trust in God, for I will praise him yet, who is my deliverer and my God. My soul is heavy within me, therefore I'll remember you from the land of Jordan, from Mizar among the hills of Hermon. Deep calls to deep in the roar of your waters. All your waves and breakers have gone over me. Surely the Lord will grant his loving mercy in the daytime, and in the night his song will be with me, a prayer to the God of my life. I will say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why must I go like a mourner because the enemy oppresses me, like a sword through my bones? My enemies have mocked me while they ask me all day long, where now is your God? Oh, why are you so full of heaviness, my soul, and why so much unquiet within me? Put your trust in God, for I will praise him yet, who is my deliverer and my God. Friends, compassion and forgiveness belong to the Lord. Though we have rebelled and wandered far off, though we doubt, though we cry out, why have you forgotten me? Let's confess our sins in penitence and faith, confident in God's forgiveness. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. An almighty God who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in repentance and faith, pardon you and me and set us free from sin. Strengthen us in all goodness and keep us in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let's give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. All glory and honour be yours, always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever living God. We give you thanks and praise for your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who by the power of your Spirit was born of Mary and lived as one of us. He was tempted in every way as we are, yet he did not sin. By his death on the cross and rising to new life, he offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. By his grace, we are able to triumph over every evil and to walk in the way of his love. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, 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 God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Holy God, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and this wine. On the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when he'd given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, Take this, this is my body given for you. Eat it in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to the disciples, saying, Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. We remember his death on the cross. We proclaim the resurrection to new life, and we await Christ's coming in glory. So we proclaim his offering of himself, made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and his glorious ascension. And looking for his coming again, we celebrate his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Father, renew us by your Spirit, that we may be united in the body of your Son and serve you as a royal priesthood in the joy of your eternal kingdom. Receive our praises, Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, through the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you in songs of never-ending praise. Blessing and honour, praise and glory be yours now and forever. Amen. Well, as I take communion here at home, you might like to pray this prayer of spiritual communion, which comes up on the screen. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us your peace. We close in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you that you assure us of your goodness and love. Accept our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving and help us to grow in love and obedience that we may serve you in the world and finally be brought to that table where all your saints feast with you forever. Friends, the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Alleluia, alleluia. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen.